May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So last week I gave you a very brief introduction to the creeds, these statements of faith. And my goal is to work through them, both exploring their historical context and meaning, and to ask the question, why, what do they still say to us today? How might we hear in them God speaking to us? So if you have your green prayer books, the creed that we're looking at first is the Nicene Creed. And in your prayer books, it's on page 123. And the opening clause there, we believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. That's a really important... I could probably preach for days on that first sentence, we believe in one God. So the first thing to recognize is this is a collective thing. As I said previously, the goal of the creeds was to get all of us onto one page, in one team, so that we might do. And the word believe. And I get very frustrated by the word believe and the way it operates, because so many people think it's about where's your head at? You know, what are the things you think about the nature of God? But I assure you, our belief and our thoughts are not always in alignment. And one of my favorite examples of this one is gamblers, problem gamblers, because they know intellectually that the casino wins, and yet they keep turning up and putting their money into the pokies or on the game with the spinny wheel, roulette. I'm a huge fan of the casinos. I know nothing about it. But so they know, but they believe something different. So I've heard this definition recently and I like it. To say I believe means to live as though this thing were true. To live as though this thing were true. And that's a really good definition, because it says it's about how we live our lives. So we collectively choose to live as though this thing were true in one God. Now, historically, this is still at a time when there are people who will look to the Caesar or the emperor and go, well, there's the Son of God, and you know, there were the Greek and Roman gods. So this is in fact in an environment where people had language for many gods. And now, Greek and Roman philosophers were comfortable with the idea that there was one God who was the source of all other godliness, if you will. But to say, I do not believe in those gods, but rather I believe in one God, would have been quite a controversial statement. And when we say we believe, we live as though that were true. For the first couple of hundred years of the Christian church, that meant I will die for the one God. Now, personally, my goal is not to have to do that. But to live into that, that would be a good thing. The Father, the Almighty. So it's, now, in this day and age, we often have some difficulties with the word Father, partially because, when we say Father, well, I picture my dad. But I know my dad is not perfect. And what did I say? The whole point of growing up is to learn to forgive your parents for the things that they didn't do right. And I'm hoping my kids will do the same as they grow up, because their dad's not perfect. And yet when we talk about God as Father, it's not a biological thing, but rather it's this idea that this This is, in a sense, the head of our household, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does it mean to say maker of heaven and earth? One of there are various different pictures of it. And when we talk about God, and we're talking about God as creator, one of them is this, that, and I don't have a problem with the Big Bang theory as the origin of the universe. It seems pretty reasonable based on how you observe the universe. But one of the ways people get around this language of maker of heaven and earth is that God sort of sits over here and he creates over here a set of conditions, and then, you know, putting a lighter to a firework. Boom! And that's the start of everything. I have some problems with that picture. One is, it says God is separate from. You know, it doesn't matter how invested a firework maker is in the fireworks, they are still separate from. And yet our experience of God is that God is deeply intimate with. And there is a different set of language, if you will, that goes with this. That God is the ground or the source of being. And so, have you ever been to the shopping centers and you see the vacuum cleaners, and they have the vacuum cleaner and it's blowing air out, and they put the ball on top and it spins in the turbulence? You've seen that? I think that's like a magic trick of physics. It's awesome. Turn off the vacuum cleaner and the whole thing drops. God is the ongoing source of heaven and earth. God is eternally present in every moment of creation, in every moment of our being. Now, what does it look like to say we live as though that were true? Well, it looks like looking at the world and seeing every part of it as a place where God is, to some extent, revealing God's nature. All things are holy. Some things, perhaps more so, because we have found in them a space where we see God more. But all things are holy, even those things that perhaps we don't like, because they guide us into a deeper understanding and relationship with God. Perhaps they challenge us to think about our own relationship with the rest of creation. And finally, that clause of all that is, seen and unseen. I was talking to a psychiatrist a while ago over a cup of coffee, because over a cup of coffee is my thing. And he was asking me, what do you think the challenges are for the church today? And I suspect he was thinking something like the results from the from the Royal Commission into child abuse. Or perhaps, because this was before the postal vote survey plebiscite thing on same-sex marriage, I suspect he thought that those were going to be where I went to. But this is my answer. Much of the world believes in its actions that only that which is seen is and is to be valued. Only the things that they can experience, only the things that they can touch, only the things that they can photograph and put on Instagram, only the things they can buy and put on the shelf have value. The value of a thing for much of the world is what it might be sold for. And the church says, no, there is more to it than that. We believe there is that which is not seen. We believe there is that which cannot be put under a microscope, dissected, and broken down. There is that which is true to the Spirit. And we speak this language, and the rest of the world looks at us and goes, "But I don't understand it." The rest of the world looks at us and says, "I don't get it." And that, I believe, is one of the great challenges for the church. And the only thing that will convince the world that there is that which is unseen is them seeing us living and valuing the Spirit of God. So when we stand in a minute to affirm the faith of the church, let us think about how it is that we might live as though this were true. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.